Psalm 68, and we will read all of the psalm through. To the chief musician, a psalm or song of David. Let God arise, let his enemies be scattered. Let them also that hate him flee before him. As the smoke is driven away, so drive them away. As wax melteth before the fire, so let the wicked perish at the presence of God. But let the righteous be glad. Let them rejoice before God. Yea, let them exceedingly rejoice. Sing unto God, sing praises to his name. Extol him that rideth upon the heavens by his name, Jah. And rejoice before him. A father of the fatherless and a judge of the widows is God in his holy habitation. God setteth the solitary in families. He bringeth out those which are bound with chains. But the rebellious dwell in a dry land. O God, when thou wentest forth before thy people, when thou didst march through the wilderness, Selah, the earth shook, the heavens also dropped at the presence of God. Even Sinai itself was moved at the presence of God, the God of Israel. Thou, O God, didst send a plentiful rain, whereby thou didst confirm thine inheritance when it was weary. Thy congregation hath dwelt therein. Thou, O God, hast prepared of thy goodness for the poor. The Lord gave the word. Great was the company of those that published it. Kings of armies did flee apace, and she that tarried at home divided the spoil. Though ye have lain among the pots, yet shall ye be as the wings of a dove, covered with silver, and their feathers with yellow gold. When the Almighty scattered kings in it, it was white as snow and salmon. The hill of God is as the hill of Bashan, and high hill as the hill of Bashan. Why leap ye, ye high hills? This is the hill which God desireth to dwell in. Yea, the Lord will dwell in it forever. The chariots of God are 20,000, even thousands of angels. The Lord is among them, as in Sinai, in the holy place. Thou hast ascended on high. Thou hast led captivity captive. Thou hast received gifts for men. Yea, for the rebellious also, that the Lord God might dwell among them. Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits, even the God of our salvation, Selah. He that is our God is the God of salvation, and unto God the Lord belong the issues of death. But God shall wound the head of his enemies, and the hairy scalp of such an one as goeth on still in his trespasses. The Lord said, I will bring again from Bashan. I will bring my people again from the depths of the sea, that thy foot may be dipped in the blood of thine enemies, and the tongue of thy dogs in the same. They have seen thy goings, O God, even the goings of my God, my King, in the sanctuary. The singers went before, the players on instruments followed after. Among them were the damsels playing with timbrels. Bless ye God in the congregations, even the Lord, from the fountain of Israel. There is little Benjamin with their ruler, the princes of Judah and their council, the princes of Zebulun and the princes of Naphtali. The Lord hath commanded thy strength. Strengthen, O God, that which thou hast wrought for us. Because of thy temple at Jerusalem shall kings bring presents unto thee. Rebuke the company of spearmen, the multitude of the bulls, with the calves of the people, till every one submit himself with pieces of silver. Scatter thou the people that delight in war. Princes shall come out of Egypt. Ethiopia shall soon stretch out her hands unto God. Sing unto God, ye kingdoms of the earth. O sing praises unto the Lord, Selah. To him that rideth upon the heavens of heavens, which were of old. Lo, he doth send out his voice, and that a mighty voice. Ascribe ye strength unto God. His excellency is over Israel, and his strength is in the clouds. O God, thou art terrible out of thy holy places. The Lord, the God of Israel, is he that giveth strength and power unto his people. Blessed be God. Amen. We know that God will bless the reading of his word to our hearts. Let us pray. O God, our Father, we commit the Bible study to you. We pray you would write your truth upon our hearts, for Christ's sake. Amen. The 19th verse is a good verse to base our remarks upon the Psalm 68. Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits, even the God of our salvation. We can't really look at this verse by verse. If we were, we would spend more than one Bible study upon it. But we can pick out the key verses. And I think the key verses revolve around this verse. What are the benefits that God loads us with? So that's what we're going to be thinking about tonight. The benefits that God gives to us. And you think of what the psalmist says here. Blessed be God who daily he loads us up with benefits. You know, God's not an Ebenezer Scrooge. He's not mingy. He's not stingy. He's not tight-fisted. He loads us with benefits every day. There's no limit to the benefits that God gives to us. Matthew Henry, he said, so many, so weighty are the gifts of God's bounty to us that he may be truly said to load us with them. He pours out his blessing till there is no room to receive them. So constant are they and so unwearied is he in doing us good that he daily loads us with them according as the necessity of every day requires. God never gets tired giving. We could get tired giving. We could. But God never gets tired giving. He never gives just out of duty. He gives because he loves us. And he will hold nothing back. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. What's the context to this psalm? When was it written? The truth is we can't quite be sure. But there are clues that are very, very helpful. This is one major clue. When we come in the scriptures to 1 Corinthians, 1 Chronicles, so turn with me over, please, to the book of 1 Chronicles. So 1 Chronicles deals with this subject. I'm just going to briefly relate to you and does it in quite some depth. You only have a brief view of it in Samuel. But in 1 Chronicles chapter 13, we have the return of the Ark of the Covenant. So the Ark of the Covenant was in Kirjath-Jearim. It had been away from the tabernacle for 20 years. And so the Ark of the Covenant was going to be returned. But as it was being returned, a man called Uzzah, one of the priests, put his hand upon the ark to steady it. And he died because they were carrying the ark the wrong way. And so the ark remained in the house of a man called Obed-Edom. That's verse 14 of 1 Chronicles 13. And it remained there. And then they discovered something. God was really blessing this man, Obed-Edom, because he was paying such reverence to the Lord through his care of the ark that God's blessing was poured out upon him. And so the decision was made that they would bring the ark onto the mount. They would bring it to Mount Zion, where the temple would subsequently be erected and it would be reunited with the tabernacle. So whenever you come to chapter 16 of 1 Chronicles, they're bringing the ark of God. And you have the description of the singers and the trumpets and all of the worship. And it was such an amazing moment. It was a spiritual highlight of David's life. God was really blessing his people with revival because they were bringing the ark to Jerusalem in God's way. The priests were carrying it. No longer was it upon a cart. That was the way the heathen transported the Ark of the Covenant whenever they took it. The Philistines, they put it in a cart. That's why Uzzah had to steady it. It was on a cart. He didn't have to steady it when the priest carried it. You see, they learned that they had to do God's work God's way. That's a lesson we all have to get. We can't do God's work our way. We have to do it God's way. We have to follow the word. And so they were doing things right. They were bringing the ark back. And then look at verse 7 of 1 Chronicles chapter 16. Then on that day, David delivered first the psalm to thank the Lord into the hand of Asaph and his brethren. Give thanks unto the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people. And so he wrote a psalm of thanksgiving to honor the Lord on this occasion. If you look at verse 34, you will see the line, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever." And you will find that repeated in the book of Psalms. You don't have it here in the Psalm 68, but you do have it in other Psalms that parallel also this event. And if you look at the notes that I sent out on the website, you will have those Psalms listed where you read about the psalmist giving thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. And you will perhaps have noticed, as we read Psalm 68, that there's reference made to the hill, verse 15. The hill of God is as the hill of Bashan. So this is a very notable moment in the history of God's people. It centers around Jerusalem, it centers around Mount Zion, and there is every indication that this psalm was written around this time when the Ark of God returned. That is a very big clue, but there is another major clue as well, and we have this over in the book of Numbers. So if you come with me, please, to the book of Numbers, chapter 10. Numbers chapter 10, the verses 35 and 36. And what is interesting here is that the Ark of God is moving. Verse 33 says, "The Ark of the Lord went before them in the 3 days' journey." The Ark of God is moving. As the Ark moved, the people moved. When the Ark set forward, in verse 35 in Numbers chapter 10, Moses said, "Rise up, Lord, and let thine enemies be scattered, and let them that hate thee flee before them." And then we come to the Psalm 68 and the verse 1. "Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let them also that hate him flee before them." The ark is moving. And so that is an even stronger indication that this was written when the ark of God was first of all brought to Jerusalem. Now, this is a song of thanksgiving. So there's great jubilation, there's great happiness because of what God is doing. And as they sang their praises unto God, they were deeply conscious of who God is. This is where doctrine comes together with practical experience. We cannot worship God properly unless we understand more and more of who God is. If we don't read our Bibles, if we don't get familiar with doctrine, we won't get to know who God is. And we worship the God whom we know, the God whom we are taught about, the God who is infinite, eternal, unchangeable, and his being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. The more we know of God, the more we ought to be humbling ourselves before him, worshipping him and praising him. Whenever you read the book of Psalms, you're deeply struck with the people had such a high view of God. You have that in the verse 4. "Sing unto God, sing praises to his name, extol him that rideth upon the heavens by his name Jah." That's a variation of the name Jehovah. "The Holy One, the one who keeps his covenant, the one who is unchanging, the Holy God of Israel, Jehovah, rejoice before him." They were filled with a sense of who God is. The problem today is that we are not filled with a sense of who God is. God's glory, the fullness of God, the power of God, the greatness, the vastness of God. Oh, if only we could get a sense of God, we'd bow down before him, worship him as John did in the Isle Patmos, falling down at his feet, because we get a fresh sense of God. Oh, that we'd be filled with God, with the glory of God, with the power of God. But this God whom we praise, he's a God that gives us benefits. He loads us with benefits. He uses all of his power to just give and give and give again. And he's richer than the richest man in the world. Everyone's talking about Elon Musk and his millions and his billions. But I tell you, God's richer still. And he gives to us. He gives to us. And we have more than the richest people in the world. For we have Christ. He daily loads us with benefits. So what are these benefits that he loads us up with? Let's just think about them. There's the goodness of God. So he gives us his goodness. God is good. And you look at verse 5, you know, just after this great statement about God riding upon the heavens, he's a father of the fatherless. He's a judge of the widows. It's God in his holy habitation. As he looks down from heaven. He sees the most vulnerable. He sees the most needy. He hears the cry of the orphan. He feels the sob of the widow. He feels their need. He setteth the solitary in families. He taketh the lonely person. Person that has nobody in this world. He gives that person a family. He brings out those which are bound with chains. Oh, those that have needs. The Lord is there to look after them. The exercise of his goodness. The one that's a prisoner has a different need from the widow, and the widow has a different need from the orphan, and they have a different need from the person that's lonely. God targets his power to meet us at the very point of our need. And so often we pray that, Lord, meet us at the point of our need. And every person in this room and every person listens online, we all have needs that are so different, needs that are known personally to ourselves, needs that we only know about, and we have needs we aren't even familiar with, even in our own hearts, because such is our own deception, our own ignorance. We don't really know what we need sometimes, but he knows. And he supplies us with his goodness. So that's the first thing we see every day is a good day, because daily the goodness of God is there. And then there is the guidance of God as well. You come to verse 7. O God, when thou wentest forth before thy people, thou didst march through the wilderness, Selah. In the wilderness, as we have already noted from Numbers 10, the Ark of the Covenant went before. And God went before the people. God marched through the wilderness. They followed him. The wilderness was a tough place, difficult place. But God made a path through the wilderness. He made a path through the Red Sea too. God made a way. And every path that they took was his plan for them. At times, their ways were ways of chastening. They shouldn't really have been in the wilderness 40 years, but because of their sin, they had to stay there. But still, it was God's design that they would be chastened in that way. But still, he was with them. At times their way seemed to take them in circles, but the Lord had a purpose in that too. God's guiding us tonight and God's leading us through every circumstance, through every incident, through everything that takes place, things that are perhaps so insignificant in our thinking, we'd hardly remember them, and yet he's directing every footstep, leading step by step. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. Now, we also notice the presence of God here as well. And there's quite a lot here. But the presence of God, in fact, the presence of God fills this whole chapter. Because David was full of God's presence as he brought the ark to Zion. Already referred to verse 15. The hill of God is as the hill of Bashan, and high hill is the hill of Bashan. Why leap ye high hills? This is the hill which God desireth to dwell in. Yea, the Lord will dwell in it forever. God's dwelling here. He's dwelling in this hill. He's dwelling in this mount. He's dwelling where the ark is. As long as the ark was away, the people were barren in their spiritual experience. They didn't know God's presence. But now the ark had come back. The Lord was dwelling with his people. God dwells among his people. Where the two and the three are gathered together in my name, Jesus said, there am I in the midst. God is wherever his people are. He never fails. It is not so much that God dwells in a physical place today. In fact, he doesn't dwell in a physical place. The Lord taught that lesson to the woman of Samaria. He said, the day will come, they that worship God will worship him in spirit and in truth. Where his people are, where his people assemble together, the Lord will be there. We only have a building to facilitate the gathering together of the people. Nothing sacred, nothing special in the building. The building is not a temple. We are the temple. People of God are the temple. God dwells with us wherever we go, however we journey. From home to workplace to holiday, he's there with his people. He will never leave us, never forsake us. But when his people gather together for worship, That's a very special time when God visits his people. And that's why it's so important for us to be in the place of worship, to be where God is. And then let's also think of another aspect of God's goodness here, the triumph of Christ. The triumph of Christ. This is one of the great messianic psalms. The messianic psalm is one that speaks of Christ, one that speaks of the Messiah. And this is a great messianic text, the verse 18. David rises from the earthly Zion to the heavenly Zion. He rises from the earthly Jerusalem to the heavenly Jerusalem. He writes of things that he didn't understand because he was inspired by the Spirit. And this text, verse 18, is immediately joined with the key text, verse 19. Thou hast ascended on high, thou hast led captivity captive, thou hast received gifts for men, yea, for the rebellious also, that the Lord God might dwell among them. Blessed be the Lord who daily loads us with benefits, even the God of our salvation, Selah. How do we know this is Christ? How do we know he's writing about Christ? Well, the Apostle Paul, and he too was inspired by the Spirit. He is the one who interpreted this. Whenever the Holy Spirit gives us the interpretation, well, we have a cast iron interpretation. Come with me over to Ephesians chapter 4, please. Ephesians 4 and the verse 7. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all things, that he might fill all things. And he gave some. Nay, we talk about the gifts. And the gifts were given, verse 12, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry. The gifts were given in verse 13, till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And he was writing about Christ. Christ ascends up on high. He gives gifts. God uses his Son to pour out his goodness and to give us his gifts. And the Son gives us these gifts because he has ascended up. And from his throne in glory, he scatters his gifts, his grace gifts for the church of Christ. And he does this every day. Just look closer at these words in verse 18. And again, as you have them in Ephesians 4. Thou hast ascended up on high, thou hast led captivity captive. The picture is of an eastern conqueror. He has led his army to victory. As he leads his army to victory, he seizes all the slaves in the possession of his enemy, and he makes those slaves his slaves. And they will work for him, and they will advance the economy of his dominion. Once they worked for another, now they work for him. And he has led captivity captive. He has made prisoners to himself. And once we were prisoners to Satan. Once we were deceived, deluded, damned and doomed, laboring for the lust of the flesh, for the things of this world. But we have been taken out of that captivity, and we're now prisoners to Christ's grace. And of course, he has made us willing to embrace this, and we are his servants. And we are here. Once we worked for the kingdom of this world, but now we work for Christ, the kingdom of the spiritual world. That is our ministry. Christ has ascended up on high. He has led captivity captive, and he has given us gifts. This is the grace of God in action. We have been conquered in order that we might serve. Make me a captive, Lord, and then I shall be free. Force me to render up my sword, and I shall conqueror be. And then we have the power for the church here as well. You look at verse 28 of the psalm. What do we read? Thy God hath commanded thy strength. Strengthen, O God, that which thou hast wrought for us. If we are to serve God and his kingdom, we need his strength and his power. God strengthens us for the need that is before us. You know, God has given us a commission To go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's our commission. Go into all the world. How are we to do that? Christ said, ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. We need the power of the Spirit. Is the power of the Spirit sufficient to enable the Church of Christ to rise above the mediocrity in which we seem so content now, and to make us more than conquerors through him that loved us? Is that not his purpose? Yes, the power is there, and we need to pray for that power. It is God's will that we might be filled with the Spirit. We might be controlled under the influence of the Spirit of God. In the Psalm 90, verse 17, Moses said, let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish thou the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the work of our hands, establish thou it. It's not about our talents. It's not about our abilities. It's not about our resources. It's about Christ working in us. There is a power for the church that we have not realized. And we need that power. And here is a promise for it. Thy God hath commanded thy strength. Strengthen, O God, that which thou hast wrought for us. And then we have the prospect for the church here. Again, we come back to this theme that we had in the last psalm. And you have in so many of the psalms. Verse 32, sing unto God, ye kingdoms of the earth, O sing praises unto the Lord. Selah, he's no longer talking about Jerusalem. He's talking about the ends of the earth. He's no longer talking about Israel. He's talking about all the kingdoms of the world. The prospect for the church, the worldwide vision. If we don't have a worldwide vision, we're missing out on Christ. That's what we're being taught here. The two are joined together. I was thinking of Revelation 19 and the words that we have concerning Christ. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And on his head were many crowns. Out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This is the prospect. Christ is no failure. Christ is no impotent king. He's all powerful. Oh, what a prospect there is for the Church of Christ in the future. And then, finally, we have the preeminence of God. Where does this psalm lead us to? Very end, verse 34. Ascribe ye strength unto God. His excellency is over Israel, and his strength is in the clouds. O God, thou art terrible out of thy holy places. The God of Israel is he that giveth strength and power unto his people. Blessed be God. It reminds me of Romans 11:36. For of him, and through him, to him, are all things. This must be the theme of the church in all ages. Soli Deo Gloria. To God be the glory. If God does not receive all the praise and all the glory through all that we do, then all that we do will be a failure. We cannot seize the glory, take it for ourselves. We cannot take the credit for ourselves. Let our names perish. Let us become the dust of the earth. Let Christ receive all the praise, for there's only one song in heaven. The Lamb alone is worthy. And may he be worthy. May we give him the worth that he is due. Tonight, as we pray, may the Lord bless these thoughts to your heart and to your soul.